This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The presidency of Warren G. Harding began on March 4, 1921, when Warren G. Harding was inaugurated as the 29th President of the United States, and ended when he died on August 2, 1923. A span of 881 days, Harding's presidency occurred during a period in American political history from the mid-1890s to 1932 that was dominated by the Republican Party, excepting after the 1912 split when Democrats held the White House for 8 years. American history texts usually call it the Progressive Era. Harding's 262 percentage point victory, 603% to 341% in the 1920 presidential election, remains the largest popular vote percentage margin in presidential elections after the so-called era of good feelings ended with the unopposed election of James Monroe in 1820. Harding's 603% of the popular vote was also the greatest percentage since 1820, but was later exceeded by Franklin Roosevelt in 1936. Lyndon Johnson in 1964, and Richard Nixon in 1972 as president. He appointed a number of well-regarded figures, including Andrew Mellon at the Treasury, Herbert Hoover at Commerce, and Charles Evans Hughes at the State Department. A major foreign policy achievement came with the Washington Naval Conference of 1921-1922, in which the world's major naval powers agreed on a naval limitations program that lasted a decade. Two members of his cabinet were implicated in corruption: Interior Secretary Albert Fall and Attorney General Harry Daugherty. Harding died of a cerebral hemorrhage caused by heart disease in San Francisco while on a Western speaking tour. He was succeeded by his vice president, Calvin Coolidge. Although he died one of the most popular presidents in history, the subsequent exposure of scandals that took place under him, such as Teapot Dome, eroded his popular regard, as did revelations of an affair by Nan Britton, one of his mistresses, in historical rankings of the U.S. presidents. Harding is often rated among the worst contents. 1. Presidential election of 1920. 11. Republican nomination. 12. General election. 13. African American lineage contention. 2. Presidency, 1921-1923. 2. Joint Session of Congress, 1921-22. Domestic and Economic Policies. 221. Bureau of the Budget and Veterans Bureau. 222. Post-War Recession and Recovery. 223. Farm Acts and Radio Conferences. 224. Revenue Act and Highway Act of 1921. 225. Fordney McCumber Tariff. 23. Foreign Policies. 231. Washington Arms Conference and Treaties. 1921-1922. 24. Civil Rights, Labor Disputes and Strikes. 241. Great Railway Strike and Repeal of 12-Hour Workday. 242. Anti-Lynching Movement and Immigration. 243. Shepherd-Towner Maternity Act. 244. Religious Toleration. 25. Life at the White House. 26. Administrative Scandals. 261. Teapot Dome. 262. Justice Department. 263. Jess W. Smith. 264. Veterans Bureau. 265. Shipping Board, Office of Alien Property and Prohibition Bureau. 27. Western Travels, Illness and Death. 271. St. Louis, Kansas, Denver. 272. Alaska Trip. 273. Death in San Francisco, State Funeral and Memorial. 28. Speculation on Cause of Death. 29. Disposition of Presidential Papers. 210. Cabinet. 211. Judicial Appointments. 21. 11. Supreme Court. 21. 12. Other Judicial Appointments. 3. Extramarital Affairs. 4. Historical Ranking as President. 5. Life Legacy. 6. Memorials. 7. Documentaries. 8. See also. 9. References. 91. Bibliography. 10. External links. Presidential election of 1920. Main article: United States presidential election, 1920. Republican nomination in 1918, when Theodore Roosevelt was entertaining plans cut short by his death in January 1919 to reprise his presidency. He considered Harding as having strong potential to run and serve as vice president, and discussed with Harry Daugherty the desirability of having Harding on his ticket in 1919. The first candidate to declare for the GOP nomination was General Leonard Wood, the GOP bosses were nevertheless determined to have a dependable listener, and were lukewarm toward the general. Some in the party began to scout for such an alternative, and Harding's name arose, despite his reluctance, due to his unique ability to draw vital Ohio votes. Also at the forefront of a throng of candidates for the nomination were Hiram Johnson, Frank Lowden, and Herbert Hoover Harry Daugherty, who became Harding's campaign manager, and who was sure none of these candidates could garner a majority, convinced Harding to run after a marathon discussion of 6+ hours. Daugherty's campaign style was variously described as pugnacious, devious, and no holds barred. For example, shortly before the GOP convention, Daugherty struck a deal with millionaire and political opportunist Jake Hammond, whereby 18 Oklahoma delegates whose votes Hammond had bought for Lowden were committed to Harding as a second choice if Lowden's effort faltered. Harding's supporters thought of him as the next McKinley. By the time the convention began, a Senate subcommittee had tallied the money spent by the various candidates, with totals as follows: Wood, $18. General election. Harding's home in Marion, Ohio, from which he conducted his 1920 front porch campaign. Photo. 1918-1921. In the 1920 election, Harding ran against Democratic Ohio Governor James M. Cox, whose running mate was Assistant Secretary of the Navy Franklin D. Roosevelt. The election theme became a rejection of the progressive ideology of the Woodrow Wilson administration in favor of the laissez-faire approach of the William McKinley era. Harding ran on a promise to return to normalcy, a seldom-used term he popularized, and healing for the nation after World War I. The policy called for an end to the abnormal era of the Great War, along with a call to reflect three trends of the time: a renewed isolationism in reaction to the war, a resurgence of nativism, and a turning away from government activism. On July 28, 1920, Harding's aide Albert Lasker, a top advertising executive from Chicago, unleashed a broad-based advertising campaign that used modern advertising techniques for the first time in a presidential campaign. Lasker's approach included newsreels and sound recordings, all in an effort to enhance Harding's patriotism and affability. Farmers were sent brochures decrying the alleged abuses of Democratic agriculture policies. African Americans and women were also given literature in an attempt to take away votes from the Democrats. Professional advertisers including Chicagoan Albert Tucker were consulted. Billboard posters, newspapers, and magazines were employed in addition to motion pictures. 5,000 speakers were trained by advertiser Harry New and sent abroad to speak for Harding. 2,000 of these speakers were women. Telemarketers were used to make phone conferences with perfected dialogues to promote Harding. Lasker had 8,000 photos distributed around the nation every 2 weeks of Harding and his wife Warren G. Harding campaigning in 1920. Lasker designed the front porch campaign during the late summer and fall of 1920 that put Harding's name and image everywhere. It was the first front porch campaign since McKinley in 1896, and the first to receive widespread newsreel coverage. It was also the first modern campaign to use the power of Hollywood and Broadway stars, who traveled to Marion for photo opportunities with Harding and his wife. Al Jolson, Lillian Russell, Douglas Fairbanks, and Mary Pickford were among the luminaries to make the pilgrimage to his house in Central Ohio. Business icons Thomas Edison, Henry Ford, and Harvey Firestone also lent their cachet to the campaign. From the onset of the campaign until the November election, over 600,000 people traveled to Marion to participate. The campaign owed a great deal to Florence Harding, who played a more active role than the wives of previous candidates had. She cultivated the relationship between the campaign and the press. As the business manager of the Star, she understood reporters and their industry. She played to their needs by being available to answer questions, pose for pictures, or deliver food from her kitchen to the press office, a bungalow that she had constructed at the rear of their property in Marion. Mrs. Harding even coached her husband on the proper way to wave to newsreel cameras to make the most of coverage. Campaign manager Lasker struck a deal with Harding's paramour, Carrie Phillips, and her husband Jim Phillips, whereby the couple agreed to leave the country until after the election. Ostensibly, Mr. Phillips was to investigate the silk trade. The campaign also drew on Harding's popularity with women considered handsome. Harding photographed well compared to Cox. However, it was mainly Harding's Senate support for women's suffrage legislation that made him popular in that demographic. Ratification of the 19th Amendment in August 1920 brought huge crowds of women to Marion, Ohio to hear Harding speak. Immigrant groups such as ethnic German Americans and Irish Americans, who made up an important part of the Democratic coalition, Coalition, also voted for Harding, in reaction to the nation's persecution of the Germans during and after the war and Wilson's retraction of support for Irish independence. The 1920 election was the first in which women could vote nationwide, and the first to be covered on the radio, thanks to KDKA 8ZZ in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, 8MK later WWJ in Detroit, and the educational and amateur radio station 1XE later WGI at Medford Hillside, Massachusetts. Historian and opponent William Estabrook Chancellor publicized the rumors, based on supposed family research, but perhaps reflecting no more than local gossip. The rumors may have been sustained by a statement Harding allegedly made to newspaperman James W. Faulkner on the subject, which he perhaps meant to be dismissive. How do I know? Jim, one of my ancestors may have jumped the fence. However, while there are gaps in the historical record, studies of his family tree have not found evidence of an African-American ancestor presidency, 1921-1923. Further information, Jazz Age, Prohibition in the United States, and Roaring Twenties. Inauguration of Warren G. Harding, March 4, 1921. Harding preferred a low-key inauguration, without the customary parade, leaving only the swearing-in ceremony and a brief reception at the White House. In his inaugural speech he declared, "Our most dangerous tendency is to expect too much from the government and at the same time do too little for it." Literary critic H. L. Mencken was appalled, announcing that, he writes, "The worst English I have ever encountered. It reminds me of a string of wet sponges, it reminds me of tattered washing on the line, it reminds me of stale bean soup, of college yells, of dogs barking idiotically through endless nights." The Hardings brought a different style to the running of the White House, though Mrs. Harding did keep a little red book of those who had offended her. The executive mansion was now once again open to the public for events including the annual Easter egg roll. Harding's administration followed the Republican national platform energized by his landslide. Harding felt the pulse of the nation, and for the 28 months in office he remained popular both nationally and internationally. Harding's administration has been critically viewed due to multiple scandals, while his successes in office were often given credit to his capable cabinet appointments that included future President Herbert Hoover. Author Wayne Lutton asked, "Was Harding really a failure?" citing former Watergate persona John Dean, who grew up near Harding's home, as saying Harding's accomplishments included income tax and federal spending reductions, economic policies that reduced stagflation, a reduction of unemployment by 10%, and a bold foreign policy that created peace with Germany, Japan, and Central America. Although Dean's work itself only cites a slight decline in unemployment figures and does not mention stagflation at all, Herbert Hoover, while serving in Harding's cabinet, was confident the president would serve two terms and return the world to normalcy later. In his own memoirs, he stated that Harding had neither the experience nor the intellect that the position needed. One of Harding's most important decisions was the appointment of former President William Howard Taft as Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, a position Taft had always coveted, more so than the presidency. Harding pushed for the establishment of the Bureau of Veterans Affairs, later organized as the Department of Veterans Affairs, the first permanent attempt at answering the needs of those who had served the nation in time of war. In April 1921, Harding spoke before a special joint session of Congress that he had called. He argued for peacemaking with Germany and Austria, emergency tariffs, new immigration laws, regulation of radio and trans-cable communications, retrenchment in government, tax reduction, repeal of wartime excess profits tax, reduction of railroad rates, promotion of agricultural interests, a national budget system, an enlarged merchant marine, and a department of public welfare. He also called for measures to end lynching, but not wanting to make enemies in his own party and with the Democrats, he did not fight for his program generally. There was a lack of strong leadership in the Congress and, unlike his predecessors Roosevelt and Wilson, Harding was not inclined to fill that void. According to biographers, Harding got along better with the press than any other previous president. Being a former newspaperman, reporters admired his frankness, candor, and his confessed limitations. He took the press behind the scenes and showed them the inner circle of the presidency. Harding, in November 1921, also implemented a policy of taking written questions from reporters during a press conference. Harding's relationship with Congress, however, was strained, and he did not receive the traditional honeymoon given to new presidents before. Hardings' election, the nation had been adrift. President Woodrow Wilson had been ill by a debilitating stroke for 18 months, and before that Wilson had been in Europe for several months attempting to negotiate a peace settlement after World War I. By contrast, at the March 4, 1921 inaugural, Harding looked strong, with gray hair and a commanding physical presence. Wilson's successor stressed the importance of the ceremonial aspects of the office of president. This emphasis fulfilled his desire to travel the breadth of the country to officiate at formal functions. Although Harding was committed to putting the best minds on his cabinet, he often rewarded those persons who were active and contributed to his campaign by appointing them to high federal department positions. Wayne Wheeler, leader of the Anti-Saloon League, was allowed by Harding to dictate who would serve on the Prohibition Commission. Graft and corruption charges permeated Harding's Department of Justice. Bootleggers confiscated tens of thousands cases of whiskey through bribery and kickbacks. Harding, out of loyalty, appointed Harry M. Daugherty to U.S. Attorney General because he felt he owed Daugherty for running his 1920 campaign. After the election, many people from the Ohio area moved to Washington, D.C., made their headquarters in a little green house on K Street, and would be eventually known as the Ohio Gang. The financial and political scandals caused by these men, in addition to Harding's own personal controversies, severely damaged Harding's personal reputation and eclipsed his presidential accomplishments. In his most open challenge to Congress, Harding forced a deferral of a budget-busting World War I soldier's bonus in an effort to reduce costs. A 2008 study of presidential rankings for The Times placed Harding at number 34, and a 2009 C-SPAN survey ranked Harding at 38 in 2010. A Siena College poll of presidential scholars placed Harding at 41. The same poll ranked Harding 26 in the ability to compromise category. Harding presided over the nation's initial consecration of the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. This followed similar commemorations established by Britain, France, and Italy. The fallen hero was chosen from a group previously interred at Romain Military Cemetery in France, and was reinterred at Arlington National Cemetery. Eugene Debs, after release from prison by President Harding, visits the White House on December 23, 1921. Harding calmed the 1919-1920 Bolshevik scare, and released an election opponent, socialist leader Eugene Debs, from prison. This was part of an effort to return the United States to normalcy after the Great War. Debs, a forceful World War I anti-war activist, had been convicted under sedition charges brought by the Wilson administration for his opposition to the draft during World War I. Despite many political differences between the two candidates, Harding commuted Debs' sentence to time served. However, he was not granted an official presidential pardon. Debs' failing health was a contributing factor for the release. Harding granted a general amnesty to 23 prisoners, alleged anarchists and socialists, active in the Red Scare. Harding's party suffered the loss of 79 seats in the House in the 1922 midterm elections, leaving them with a razor-thin majority. The president determined to fill the void of leadership in the party and attempted to take a more aggressive role in setting the legislative agenda. The Hardings visited their home community of Marion, Ohio, once during the term, when the city celebrated its centennial during the first week of July. Harding arrived on July 3, gave a speech to the community at the Marion County Fairgrounds on July 4, and left the following morning for other speaking commitments. Joint session of Congress 1921. On April 12, Harding called a joint session of Congress to address matters that he deemed of national and urgent importance. That speech, considered his best, contained few political platitudes and was enthusiastically received by Congress. On the economic front, Harding urged Congress to create a Bureau of the Budget, cut expenditures, and revise federal tax law. Harding urged increased protectionist tariffs, lower taxes, and agriculture legislation to help farmers. In the speech, Harding advocated aviation technology for civil and military purposes, development and regulation of radio technology, and passage of a federal anti-lynching law to protect African Americans. Harding advocated, in terms of foreign affairs, a conference and cooperation of nations to prevent war, yet flatly stated that the U.S. should not enter the League of Nations. Harding endorsed peace between all former enemy nations from World War I and the funding and liquidation of war debts. Domestic and Economic Policies. Bureau of the Budget and Veterans Bureau. Charles Dawes, the first budget director. Harding signed the Budget and Accounting Act of 1921, considered one of his greatest domestic and enduring achievements. achievements, Harding got authorization from Congress for the country's first formal budgeting process, establishing of the Bureau of the Budget. The law created the position of Presidential Budget Director, who was directly responsible to the President rather than to the Secretary of Treasury. The law also stipulated that the President must annually submit a budget to the U.S. Congress, and all presidents since have had to do so. The General Accounting Office was created to assure oversight in the federal budget expenditures. Harding appointed Charles Dawes as the Bureau of the Budget's first director, known for his position as an effectrive financier. Dawes reduced government spending by $15 billion his first year as director, a 25% reduction, along with another 25% reduction the following year. In effect, the government budget was nearly cut in half in just 2 years. Harding believed the federal government was supposed to be fiscally managed in a way similar to private sector businesses. He had campaigned on the slogan, "Less government in business and more business in government." Harding was true to his word, carrying on budget cuts that had begun under a debilitated Woodrow Wilson. Federal spending declined from $63 billion in 1920 to $5 billion in 1921 and $33 billion in 1922. Tax rates, meanwhile, were slashed, for every income group, and over the course of the 1920s, the national debt was reduced by one-third. On August 9, 1921, Harding signed the Sweet Bill, which established the a new agency known as the Veterans Bureau after World War I. 300,000 wounded veterans were in need of hospitalization, medical care, and job training to handle the needs of these veterans. The new agency incorporated the War Risk Insurance Bureau, the Brig Gen Charles E. Sawyer's Federal Hospitalization Bureau, along with three other bureaus that dealt with veteran affairs. Harding regretted appointed Colonel Charles R. Forbes, albeit a decorated war veteran, as the Veteran Bureau's first director. See scandal below, a position that reported directly to the President. The Veterans Bureau later was incorporated into the Veterans Administration and ultimately the Department of Veterans Affairs. Post-war recession and recovery. Main article, Depression of 1920-21. Secretary of Treasury Andrew W. Mellon. On March 4, Harding assumed office while the nation was in the midst of a post-war economic decline, known as the Depression of 1920-21. By the summer of his first year in office, an economic recovery began. He convened the Conference of Unemployment in 1921, headed by Secretary of Commerce Herbert Hoover, that proactively advocated stimulating the economy with local public work projects and encouraged businesses to apply shared work programs. Harding's Treasury Secretary Andrew Mellon ordered a study that claimed to demonstrate that as income tax rates were increased, money was driven underground or abroad. Mellon concluded that lower rates would increase tax revenues. Based on this advice, Harding began cut taxes in 1922. The top marginal rate was annually reduced in four stages, from 73% in 1921 to 25% in 1925. Taxes were cut for lower incomes. Starting in 1923, revenues to the Treasury decreased substantially. Libertarian historian Thomas Woods contends that the tax cuts ended the Depression of 1920-1921. Historians Schweikert and Allen also attribute this to the tax cuts. They argue that Harding's tax and economic policies in part has attributed the improvement to the earlier monetary policy of the Federal Reserve, and notes that the changes in marginal tax rates were accompanied by an expansion in the tax base that could account for the increase in revenue. Robert Gordon, a Keynesian, notes, government policy to moderate the depression and speed recovery was minimal. The Federal Reserve authorities were largely passive. Legislation emanated from President Woodrow Wilson's 1919 Federal Trade Commission report, which investigated and discovered manipulations, controls, trusts, combinations, or restraints out of harmony with the law or the public interest. In the meatpacking industry, the first law was the Packers and Stockyards Act, which prohibited packers from engaging in unfair and deceptive practices. Two amendments were made to the Farm Loan Act of 1916 that President Wilson had signed into law, which had expanded the maximum size of rural farm loans. The Emergency Agriculture Credit Act authorized new loans to farmers to help them sell and market livestock. The Kapper-Volstead Act, signed by Harding on February 18, 1922, protected farm cooperatives from antitrust legislation. The Future Trading Act was also enacted, regulating puts and calls, bids, and offers on futures contracting. Later, on May 15, 1922, the Supreme Court ruled this legislation unconstitutional. On February 27, 1922, 1922, Harding implemented the first of a series of radio conferences headed by Secretary of Commerce Herbert Hoover. The last Radio Act of 1912 was considered inadequate and chaotic. Change was necessary to help the fledgling radio industry. At the first meeting, 30 representatives, including amateurs, governmental agencies, and the radio industry, made cooperative efforts to ensure the public interest in broadcasting, who would broadcast, and for what purpose, and to curb direct advertising. Also discussed was how wattage power used by broadcasters would be distributed depending on the radio station's conditional use and location. A second radio conference was called in 1923, and this time Secretary Hoover successfully obtained radio regulation power without legislation. Hoover himself, in January 1923, told the press there was an urgent need for radio regulation. Large radio stations such as Westinghouse advocated that only 25 larger radio stations in large metropolitan areas be allowed to broadcast, while smaller stations would be given limited power at the end of the meeting. The industrialists agreed to give Hoover the power to regulate hours and wavelengths of operation of stations when such action is necessary to prevent interference detrimental to the public good. Harding became the first president to have a radio in his office. When on February 8, 1922, he had a radio set installed in the White House so he could listen to news and music as his schedule permitted on June 14, Harding was also the first president that the American public heard on the new mass medium. He spoke on radio at a dedication site in honor of Francis Scott Key, who wrote the words to the Star-Spangled Banner. Revenue Act and Highway Act of 1921 left to right, Henry Ford, Thomas Edison, Harding, and Harvey Firestone, 1921. On November 22, 1921, Harding signed the Revenue Act of 1921, which greatly reduced taxes for the wealthiest Americans. Protests from Republican farmers caused the deductions to be less. Then Secretary of Treasury Andrew Mellon desired the lengthy 96-page act reduced the corporate tax from 65% to 50% and provided for ultimate elimination of the excess profits tax. During World War I, the 1920s were a time of modernization for America to improve and expand the nation's highway system. Harding signed the Federal Highway Act of 1921. From 1921 to 1923, the federal government spent $162. Advocated tariff legislation. The tariffs established in the 1920s have historically been viewed as a contributing factor to causing the Wall Street crash of 1929. Foreign policies. Harding was very specific in commenting on the appointment of Secretary of State Charles E. Hughes, that the secretary would be the sole spokesman for the State Department as opposed to the Wilson administration. The U.S. Senate had refused to ratify the Treaty of Versailles in both 1919 and 1920 because it required the U.S. to endorse the League of Nations. Hughes worked behind the scenes to formally make peace with Germany and the successor states to Austria-Hungary. Austria and Hungary. This began with the Knox-Porter Resolution, the U.S.-German Peace Treaty. U.S.-Austrian Peace Treaty and U.S.-Hungarian Peace Treaty were ratified in 1921. Washington Arms Conference and Treaties 1921-1922. Main article: Washington Naval Conference. Charles Evans Hughes, former Supreme Court Justice and Harding's Secretary of State. Harding spearheaded, with the urging of the Senate, a monumental global conference, held in Washington, D.C., to limit the armaments of world powers, including the U.S., Japan, Great Britain, France, Italy, China, Belgium, Netherlands and Portugal. Harding's Secretary of State, Charles E. Hughes, assumed a primary role in the conference and made the pivotal proposal. The U.S. would reduce its number of warships by 30 if Great Britain decommissioned 19, and Japan 17 ships starting on November 6, 1921 and ending February 6, 1922. World leaders met to control a naval arms race and to bring stability to East Asia. The conference enabled the great powers to potentially limit their large naval deployment and avoid conflict in the Pacific. The delegation of nations also worked out security issues and promoted cooperation in the Far East. The conference produced six treaties and 12 resolutions among the participating nations, which ranged from limiting the size or tonnage of naval ships to custom tariffs. The treaties, which easily passed the Senate, also included agreements regulating submarines, dominions in the Pacific, and dealings with China. The treaties only remained in effect until the mid-1930s, however, and ultimately failed. Japan eventually invaded Manchuria and the arms limitations no longer had any effect. The building of monster warships resumed and the U.S. and Great Britain were unable to quickly quickly rearm themselves to defend an international order and stop Japan from remilitarizing Harding, in an effort to improve U.S. relations with Mexico, Latin America, and the Caribbean islands implemented a program of military disengagement on April 20, 1921. The Thompson-Arusha Treaty with Colombia was ratified by the Senate and signed by Harding, that awarded $25 million as indemnity payment for land used to make the Panama Canal. Harding stunned the capital when he sent to the Senate a message supporting the participation of the U.S. in the proposed Permanent Court of International Justice. This was not favorably received by Harding's colleagues. A resolution was nevertheless drafted, in deference to the president, and then promptly buried in the Foreign Affairs Committee Civil Rights, Labor Disputes and Strikes when the governor of West Virginia Ephraim Morgan in 1921 requested federal troops to stop miners who were battling state police and militia. Harding issued two proclamations to keep the peace. Finally, he sent in an army unit who ended the mini-war Great Railway Strike and repeal of 12-hour workday main article, Great Railroad Strike of 1922, a year after Harding contended with the 1921 mining labor war in West Virginia. A strike broke out during the summer of 1922 in the railroad industry on July 1, 1922. 400,000 railroad workers and shopmen went on strike over hourly wages reduced by 7 cents and a 12. Injunction, which enraged the Union as well as many in Congress, as it prohibited First Amendment rights. Harding had Daugherty and Wilkerson withdraw the objectionable parts of the injunction. The injunction ultimately succeeded in ending the strike. However, tensions remained high between railroad workers and company men for years. Daugherty's harsh injunction against labor created great discord in Harding's cabinet. This, along with Daugherty's other activities, prompted one Minnesota congressman, Oscar Keller, to unsuccessfully attempt to bring impeachment charges against the Attorney General in 1922. Harding and Secretary of Commerce Herbert Hoover convened a White House conference with manufacturers and unions to reduce the length of the 12-hour workday. In a move for the cause of labor, the labor movement supported an 8-hour day and a 6-day workweek. Harding wrote Judge Gary, head of U.S. Steel, advocating labor reform. The labor conference, however, decided against labor's demands in 1923. Both Harding and Hoover were disappointed with the committee's ruling. Harding wrote a second letter to Gary, and with public support the steel industry repealed the 12-hour workday to an 8-hour workday. Anti-lynching movement and immigration. Leonidas C. Dyer. Notably, in an age of severe racial intolerance during the 1920s, Harding did not hold any racial animosity, according to historian Carl S. Anthony in a speech on October 26, 1921. Given in segregated Birmingham, Alabama. Harding advocated civil rights for African Americans, the first president to openly advocate black political, educational, and economic equality during the 20th century. In the Birmingham speech, Harding wanted African Americans to have equal educational opportunities and greater voting rights in the South. The white section of the audience listened in silence while the black section of the segregated audience cheered. Harding went further and viewed the race problem as a national and international issue and desired that the sectionalism of the Solid South and black membership of the Republican Party be broken up. Harding, however, openly stated that he was not for black social equality in terms of racial mixing or intermarriage. Harding also spoke on the Great Migration, believing that blacks migrating to the North and West to find employment had actually harmed race relations between blacks and whites. He named some African Americans to federal positions, such as Walter L. Cohen of New Orleans, Louisiana, whom he named Controller of Customs. Harding also advocated the establishment of an international commission to improve race relations between whites and blacks. However, strong political opposition by the Southern Democratic Bloc prevented the commission. The Ku Klux Klan had its highest membership during its revival in the early 1920s. Harding supported Congressman Leonidas Dyer's federal anti-lynching bill, known as the Dyer Bill, which passed the House of Representatives on January 26, 1922. The bill was defeated in the Senate by a Democratic filibuster. Harding had previously spoken out publicly against lynching on October 21, 1921. Congress had not debated a civil rights bill since the 1890 Federal Elections Bill. The Per Centum Act of 1921, signed by Harding on May 19, 1921, reduced the numbers of immigrants to 3% of a country's represented population based on the 1910 census. The act allowed unauthorized immigrants to be deported. Harding and Secretary of Labor James Davis believed that enforcement had to be humane. Harding often allowed exceptions, granting reprieves to thousands of immigrants. Shepherd-Towner Maternity Act. On November 21, 1921, Harding signed the Shepherd-Towner Maternity Act, the first major federal government social welfare program in the U.S. The law funded almost 3,000 child and health centers throughout the U.S. Medical doctors were spurred to offer preventative health care measures in addition to treating ill children. Doctors were required to help healthy pregnant women and prevent healthy children from getting sick. Child welfare workers were sent out to make sure that parents were taking care of their children. The law was sponsored by Julia Lathrop, America's first director of the U.S. Children's Bureau. Although the law remained in effect only 8 years, it set the trend for New Deal social programs. During the 1930s, many women who had been given the right to vote in 1920 were given career opportunities as welfare and social workers. Religious toleration. Harding was tolerant towards other religious faiths. He appointed prominent Rabbi Joseph S. Kornfeld and Father Joseph M. Denning to foreign diplomatic positions. He also appointed Albert Lasker, a Jewish businessman and Harding's 1920 presidential campaign manager, head of the shipping department. In an unpublished letter, Harding advocated the establishment and funding of a Jewish homeland in Palestine. Life at the White House. President Harding with his dog Laddie Boy. Photo, 1922. Catherine Marcia Forbes, wife of Harding's Veterans Bureau appointment. Charles R. Forbes had unprecedented access to the White House. Mrs. Harding and Catherine had become close friends since meeting in Hawaii. When Senator Harding and his wife were on vacation in 1921, Catherine Forbes wrote a series of articles for the Washington Post describing the daily life of President Harding and the First Lady. President Harding and Mrs. Harding wanted to be known as just home folks. At dinners, Harding's dog Laddie Boy was allowed to beg guests for food and play with children. Red velvet upholstery covered much of the furniture. Harding's informal dress included a plain tuxedo, pleated shirt, and pearl studs. Mrs. Harding herself was able to talk with many guests at the same time inside the White House. The Hardings had a great-grandfather clock, a gold fish bowl, a French vase with pussy willows, neutral color rugs, and a grand piano. Harding sometimes gave children private tours of the White House that included the conservatories and kennels. Harding's lifestyle at the White House was fairly unconventional compared to his predecessor, President Woodrow Wilson. Upstairs at the White House, in the yellow oval room, Harding allowed bootleg whiskey to be freely served to his guests during after-dinner parties at a time when the president was supposed to enforce prohibition. One witness, Alice Longworth, daughter of President Theodore Roosevelt, stated that trays, with bottles containing every imaginable brand of whiskey, stood about. Some of this alcohol had been directly confiscated from the Prohibition Department by Jess Smith, assistant to U.S. Attorney General Harry Daugherty. Mrs. Harding, also known as the Duchess, mixed drinks for the guests. Harding played poker twice a week, smoked and chewed tobacco. Harding allegedly won a $4,000 pearl necktie pin at one White House poker game. Although criticized by prohibitionist advocate Wayne B. Wheeler over Washington, D.C. rumors of these wild parties, Harding claimed his personal drinking inside the White House was his own business. Administrative scandals. Upon winning the election, Harding appointed many of his longtime allies and campaign contributors to prominent political positions in control of vast amounts of government money and resources known as the Ohio Gang, a term used by Charles Meade Jr. in his book of the same name. Some of the appointees used their new powers to exploit their positions for personal gain. Although Harding was responsible for making these appointments, it is unclear how much, if anything, Harding himself knew about his friends' illicit activities. No evidence to date suggests that Harding personally profited from such crimes, but he was apparently unable to prevent them. "I have no trouble with my enemies," Harding told journalist William Allen White late in his presidency, "but my damn friends, they're the ones that keep me walking the floor nights." The only scandal which was openly discovered during Harding's lifetime was in the Veterans Bureau, yet the gossip became rampant after the suicides of Charles Kramer. Veterans Bureau and Jess Smith. Justice Department. Harding responded aggressively to all of this with a mixture of grief, anger and perplexity before any of the scandalous activity became widely known. Harding's popularity began to ebb, but he responded with determination to run for re-election, despite strong support emerging for the very popular Henry Ford for the Democrats. While on his trip to Alaska in 1923, Harding asked reporters and Secretary of Commerce Herbert Hoover how he should respond to associates who may have betrayed him. He also said at this time, according to Joe Mitchell Chapel, "Someday the people will understand all that some of my erstwhile friends have done for me." However much he did know at the time of his departure for Alaska. Russell concludes it did not include Fall and Daugherty. Harding reformed the Corrupt Veterans Bureau in March, 1923. Teapot Dome. Further information, Teapot Dome scandal. Albert B. Fall, Harding's first Secretary of the Interior and the first former cabinet member sent to prison. The most notorious scandal was Teapot Dome, most of which came to light after Harding's death. This affair concerned an oil reserve in Wyoming that was covered by a teapot-shaped rock formation for years. The country had taken measures to ensure the availability of petroleum reserves, particularly for the Navy's use. On February 23, 1923, Harding issued Executive Order No. 3797, which created the Naval Petroleum Reserve No. 4 in Alaska. By the 1920s, it was clear that petroleum was important to the national economy and security. The reserve system was to keep the oil under government jurisdiction rather than subject to private claims. Management of these reserves was the subject of multi-dimensional arguments, beginning with a turf battle between the Secretary of the Navy and the Interior Department. The strategic reserves issue was also a debate topic between conservationists and the petroleum industry, as well as those who favored public ownership versus private control. Harding's Secretary of the Interior, Albert B. Fall, brought to that office significant political and legal experience. In addition to heavy personal debt, incurred in his obsession to expand his personal estate, Three Rivers, in New Mexico, he also was an avid supporter of the private ownership and management of reserves. Fall contracted Edward Doheny of Pan American Corp. to build storage tanks in exchange for drilling rights. It later came to light that Doheny had made significant personal loans to Fall. The secretary also negotiated leases for the Teapot Dome reserves to Harry Sinclair of the Consolidated Oil Corp. in return for guaranteed oil reserves to the credit of the government. Again, it later emerged that Sinclair had personally made concurrent cash payments of over $400,000 to Fall. These activities took place under the watch of progressive and conservationist attorney Harry A. Slattery, acting for Gifford Pinchot and Robert La Follette. Fall was ultimately convicted in 1931 of accepting bribes and illegal no-interest personal loans in exchange for the leasing of public oil fields to business associates. In 1931, Fall was the first cabinet member in history imprisoned for crimes committed while in office. Paradoxically, while Fall was convicted for taking the bribe, Doheny was acquitted of paying it. Justice Department. Harry M. Daugherty, U.S. Attorney General. Photo taken 1920. Harding's appointment of Harry M. Daugherty as Attorney General received more criticism than any other as Harding's campaign manager. Daugherty's Ohio lobbying and backroom maneuvers with politicians were not considered the best qualifications. Historian M. Justice Department, who had committed suicide. Harding's Attorney General hired William J. Burns to run the Justice Department's Bureau of Investigation. Burns was said to be unabashed in his willingness to conduct unauthorized searches and seizures of political enemies of the Justice Department. A number of inquisitive congressmen or senators found themselves the object of wiretaps, rifled files, and copied correspondence. Burns' primary operative was Gaston B. Means, a reputed con man, who was known to have fixed prosecutions, sold favors, and manipulated files in the Justice Department. Means, who acted independently, took direct instructions and payments from Jess Smith, without Burns' knowledge, to spy on Congressman. Means hired a woman, Laura Jacobson, to spy on Senator Thaddeus Carraway, a critic of the Harding administration. Means also was involved with roping bootleggers. Narcotic trafficking was rampant at the Atlanta Penitentiary while Daugherty was Attorney General. The appointed warden, Jadeich, made internal prison reforms by firing two guards while two other officers were indicted by the Justice Department. Daugherty, however, was slow to follow up on these indictments as Deitch began to investigate the drug supply ring outside the prison. Daugherty fired him and replaced him with a close friend, A.E. Sartain. Daugherty stopped the investigation into the drug ring until the two indicted officers were brought to trial. The superintendent of prisons, Eber Votaw, allegedly interfered and suppressed Deitch's attempted investigation into the narcotic ring outside the prison. Votaw was Harding's brother-in-law and had been appointed by the president in April 1921. Harding sent Charles R. Forbes, director of the Veterans Bureau, to privately investigate the matter. This upset Daugherty, who said the Atlanta prison situation was none of Forbes's business. Daugherty, according to a 1924 Senate investigation into the Justice Department, had authorized a system of graft between aides Jess Smith and Howard Mannington. Both Mannington and Smith allegedly reportedly took bribes to secure appointments, prison pardons, and freedom from prosecution. A majority of these purchasable pardons were directed towards bootleggers. Cincinnati bootlegger, George L. Remus, allegedly paid Jess Smith $250,000 to not prosecute him. Remus, however, was prosecuted, convicted, and sentenced to Atlanta prison. Smith tried to extract more bribe money from Remus to pay for a pardon. The prevalent question at the Justice Department was, how is he fixed? Jess W. Smith. Jess Smith Daugherty's personal aide, Jess W. Smith, was widely viewed as the Attorney General's and therefore the President's spokesman and henchman. Smith was considered Daugherty's proxy, and a central figure, in government file manipulation, paroles and pardons, influence peddling, and even served as bagman. During Prohibition, pharmacies received alcohol permits to sell alcohol for medical purposes, according to congressional testimony. Daugherty allegedly arranged for Jess Smith and Howard Mannington to sell these permits to drug company agents who really represented bootleggers. The bootleggers, having obtained a permit, could buy cases of whiskey. Smith and Mannington split the permit sales profits. Approximately 50,000 to 60,000 cases of whiskey were sold to bootleggers at a net worth of $750,000 to $900,000. Smith supplied bootleg whiskey to the White House and the Ohio Gang House on K Street, concealing the whiskey in a briefcase for poker games. Eventually, rumors of Smith's abuses, free use of government cars, going to all-night parties, manipulation of Justice Department files, reached Harding. Harding withdrew Smith's White House clearance, and Daugherty told him to leave Washington on May 30, 1923. Smith's dead body was found at Daugherty's apartment with a gunshot wound to the head. William J. Burns immediately took Smith's body away, and there was no autopsy. Historian Francis Russell, concluding this was a suicide, indicates that a Daugherty aide entered Smith's room moments after a noise awoke him, and found Smith on the floor with his head in a trash can and a revolver in his hand. Russell also states that Smith had purchased the gun, though he was said to have detested guns, that a bullet had entered Smith's temple, exited the forehead, and lodged in a door jamb. Smith allegedly purchased the gun from a hardware store shortly before his death. After Daugherty verbally abused him for waking him up from a nap, Veterans Bureau Charles R. Forbes, director of the Veterans Bureau and convicted of defrauding the government. Charles R. Forbes, the energetic director of the Veterans Bureau, disregarded the dire needs of wounded World War I veterans to procure his own wealth to limit corruption in the Veterans Bureau. Harding insisted that all government contracts be by public notice, but Forbes provided inside information to his co-conspirators to ensure their bids succeeded after his appointment. Forbes was quick to have Harding issue executive orders that gave him control over veterans' hospital construction and supplies. Forbes defrauded the government of an estimated $225.